Hi there YouTube, I think it's time to remake my Stable Diffusion Automatic 1111 installation tutorial video and retire the old one. There's been some changes, particularly to the YAML files. You don't have to install them anymore, which was really confusing if you were watching how to install them and where to find them, and the links might be gone and you don't need to do it anymore. It's a waste of time. I was kind of waiting for 2.2 to come out, but it's just lagging for some reason and it's not here yet to fix the disaster, which was 2.1. I'm going to show you how to install version 1.5, 2.1, and custom models of version 1.5. I recommend going with those custom models for 1.5 and skipping 2.1 altogether, but I will show you the commands how to run 2.1. Before we get started, this is an NVIDIA only installation and there's going to be an AMD and Apple installation video in the video description. We also need at least 2 GB of VRAM, but I recommend 4 to 6. 2 is going to be hard to work with. You're going to get a lot of out of VRAM errors. You're going to have to render images in under 512 by 512 resolution, if not lower. All right, so let's get started. The first step is to download and install Python 3.10.6. And you want to make sure it's that version or you're going to run into some trouble when you start downloading some of your dependencies like PyTorch. So just keep it to that version for now. I know you want the latest and greatest of Python, but just stick to the rivers and waters that you used to, or you're going to have a lot of problems.
Is that accidental or are you trying to quote TLC on purpose?
I don't even understand the reference.
And something that's really important is that you want to add Python to path. So in the beginning of your installation on the new installers, it's going to ask you to do that. And so you want to make sure that's checkmark, add Python to path, and then you should be okay. If you don't do that, you're going to have trouble. And if you don't get that option in the beginning, you have a different installer, go ahead and go into customize installation and look for it, because you really want to do this, or you're going to have to do it later on the back end, which is a pain in the butt. Next, you want to install Git, and this one's going to be really easy. Just download the appropriate one for your PC and then click next, 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 next until you're done. And that's it. And you won't access Git directly. You're going to be using this through Python.
Python?
Finally, there's CUDA drivers, and this is only for the people that have the modern NVIDIA graphics cards. And these are the Pascal, Turing, Ampere, Lovelace, and Hopper chipsets that I really... To be honest, I don't know what that means. I just looked that up. So anything a 1080 or above, you know, GTX 1080, 1070 maybe, and definitely the RTX series should be able to accept these drivers. All right, so now we have all the prereqs installed. So now we need to install Automatic 1111. So go ahead and click on the link in my video description, Automatic 111, Stable Diffusion Web UI, and it's going to bring you to this page here. And then on this page, you want to click on the green code button and then just go to download zip and then download that somewhere on your desktop and then open it up and just extract it wherever you want. So I just do that by grabbing it and dragging it outside of the zip folder. Cool, now you have the repository files. Another way to do this is go to the green code button on the Automatic 1111 site again, and then click on the little double square icon here, and that's going to copy the link for this repository. And the only difference between this and the address bar one is that there's .git at the end. Now go into any folder that you created and click in the address bar and type in cmd. And press enter. And this will actually open up command prompt inside that folder, so you don't have to do a change directory or a cd and then the address path. All you gotta do now is type in git clone and then paste in the address. You can do that by pressing Control V or right clicking inside the command prompt. Then press enter and it should install the repositories into that folder. As you can see, I now have a Stable Diffusion Web UI folder. Same thing as the zip file. Some people would argue that the GitHub pull is a lot more updated, but who knows? I don't know if that's true or not. You now have the Automatic 1111 repository on your PC, and that's good to go. You now need to choose a model, and just remember you can choose multiple models, and version 2.1 is going to require some special settings, so just keep that in mind. So here's a couple options. So the first one is version 1.5. The next one is version 2.1, and then I'm going to show you how to get a custom model, and you can get a particular look or art style, which is pretty cool. There's a lot of different art styles to choose from, and they're really nice, and it'll help you get good image every time. Let's take a look at the Stable Diffusion 2.1 Hugging Face files. You have a couple options, but let's take a look at the extensions first. So Safetensors would be less flexible to go onto other image creators, which I don't know why you'd want to do that, but it's safer though because it prevents pickling. And the bad thing with pickling is when you serialize the data and it comes out, there's a potential for malware, which there was a rumor back in the past that one of the CKPT files had it. So Safetensor is the safer option, but less flexible. Then you have EMA or non-EMA. EMA stands for Exponential Moving Average. And this one is like, if you look online, there's a lot of arrogant people just kind of like copy and pasting a lot of information. But all you need to know is the EMA is good for training because it can remember some stuff and it can train it a little bit better. And then you probably want the non-EMA, which is for inference or image creation. So just stick with that and just break it down that way. EMA is for training, non-EMA is for creating pictures. It's the easiest way to think about it. Now that you know what to download, go ahead and choose one. So I'm going to choose the non-EMA Safetensor one. And I'm just going to click right here on the down arrow to download the file. And then I'm going to grab one for the 1.5, EMA only with Safetensors again. And now I'm going to go to Civit AI and download a custom model. All right, so I found a model that I really like. And just keep in mind, these are all like 5 gigs. So plan accordingly with space in your hard drive. That's a pretty standard size for a checkpoint file. And I want to ensure that the base model is 1.5, which there's not very many 2.1 models in the first place. So I'm taking a look at these pictures and I like this art style and I want to create a lot of this type of art. So I'm going to go ahead and download this one right here. And it's just going to be like the other models. I'm just going to wait till it downloads and then drag it into the models folder for Stable Diffusion. Speaking of dragging models into your models folder, let's do that right now. All right, so I have all my downloaded models here on the left side. So I have the 2.1 model, I have a 1.5 Inpainting, I have the regular 1.5, and I have the custom one that I got from Civit AI. And we're going to use all of these models. So on the right side, I got my Stable Diffusion folder up. So I'm going to open the models folder in Stable Diffusion, and then I'm going to click on Stable Diffusion and just grab all your models and drag them over. Now that you have all the models where it needs to be in the Stable Diffusion models folder, Stable Diffusion, it's time to run your Webui-user.bat file, which you're going to get very familiar with. This is going to allow you to download your dependencies, and it's also going to be the file that you use to start up Stable Diffusion. So to get there, just go up two folders. Right here in your main folder, you're going to see your Webui-user.bat file, and this is going to be the file that you use every time to run it. But right now, for the first run, it's actually going to install dependencies automatically. So just go ahead and click on that and let it do its thing. It's going to take about 10 minutes. It's going to be downloading something called PyTorch, which is, I think it's like 7 gigs, and there's just a bunch of stuff it's going to be downloading. So just let it do its thing and just let it install. After you installed your dependencies, you're going to use the web UI user bat file again. And when you double click on it, this time you're actually just going to get the command prompt and it's going to load Stable Diffusion. The way you know it's running is that it'll say running on local URL. You can actually just hold control and left click and it'll start up Stable Diffusion. And that's pretty much it. You're in Stable Diffusion now and it's up and running. Just make sure up here at the top left that you have the correct model chosen. Right now it's 2.1. I don't like 2.1, so I'm going to choose something else. And you guys could choose 2.1 if you want. And I'll have another video for troubleshooting with 2.1 and how to deal with it. And that'll be a totally separate video. It could be 10 minutes long by itself. And from now on, you're going to be starting Stable Diffusion with the same file you use to install it, which is the webui-user.bat file. Except this time, it's not going to be downloading any dependencies, so it's going to start up a lot faster. But once you get that running on local URL 127.0.0.1, which is your local URL, and then :7860, which is your port, you can just hold control down and left click on that address, or you can copy and paste that into your browser or type it in.
Well, hello there. I just wanted to take this moment to ask you to click the like button. Being a small YouTube channel, it really helps me out and I'd appreciate it. I feel funny for some reason.
If you're trying to use version 2.1, you probably ran into a couple errors already, or you're producing black images or blank images. So to fix this, we're going to have to edit our webui-userbat file. So go ahead and go into your Stable Diffusion main directory and then right click on that file, the webui-user.bat file, and then click on show more options and then go to edit. And now this is how we're going to add arguments to this to actually use xformers and fix our version 2.1. So for me, since I have CUDA drivers, I'm going to type in --xformers. But if you have a different issues or you don't have xformers, you might have to type in --no half. And I'm going to warn you, that's going to make it really slow for image generation. So you better make sure that xformers are not an option if you use this. And then I had a 1660 and I had one of those cards that underclocked themselves, and you had to actually put --precision full, and that should help you there. And then I had another one where I had to use --med vram. So I would stop running out of VRAM. And yeah, these are all for version 2.1. If you have version 1.5 or one of the custom models, you don't have to put anything in here except xformers, so you can optimize your inference or text to image generation. But those are some things to get started with to fix version 2.1. I recommend starting with xformers, then go to no half, and then precision full and med VRAM. A lot of issues. Actually, I take that back. I recommend just dropping 2.1 and going to 1.5 with a custom model. Congrats, you should now have everything up and running. So now let's click on the Webui-user.bat file to start up Stable Diffusion. And then you'll get your command prompt. And then when it's done, it's going to say running on local URL http://127.0.0.1:7860. You can either hold control and left click or copy and paste that address in the address bar. I already kind of have it saved, so I just type in 1, 2 and it shows up. So the first tab you're looking at is probably the main tab that you're going to be using. So this is the text to image tab. And then here at the top, you'll see the prompt. This text prompt is where you type in what you want to create. I put a medieval war with knights and elves, orcs, and this is kind of what this model's about. So I'm going to try that. Right below your image prompt box, you got your negative image prompt. And that's very important for version 2.1. You got to put like a paragraph worth of stuff or it's going to end up jacked up. So you can actually go online and find like pre-built ones, but who knows what should go in there. It depends on whatever picture you're putting in. But things like blurry, out of frame, or pixelated, things that you wouldn't expect to have to put in, you got to put in for version 2.1. They say it's a feature, not a bug, which is weird. Next is your sampling method. And I would just stick to Euler or Euler A for now until you get more comfortable with the tool, and then move on to the DPM Keras ones, which I like a lot. But typically I'll create a picture with Euler AI and do all my testing that way. And next is sampling steps. So this is gonna be the amount of steps it takes to create your picture, and it'll make a better picture the more steps you put, but it's gonna take longer because it's gonna have to do each step. But I think for Euler under 50 is usually pretty good. And when you want like super fine details or if you're doing like a latent upscale, then you could up the step. Next, we have restore faces. This does a miracle on the faces, but it kind of ruins the art style if you have a particular art style that you're going for. If you have like a impasto oil painting type of art, like it's gonna smooth it out. So just keep that in mind. I would actually say don't do this unless you're coming up with a lot of ugly faces, and just send your picture to extras tab and then you can fix it in there by using GFPGAN or CodeFormer. Next is tiling. This one's pretty self-explanatory. It creates a tile pattern of whatever you ask for. After that is high res fix. If you have a blurry or smudgy image, this should help fix that. So if you're consistently getting bad images, click this. And also if you're getting double images, like if you're getting two heads in a picture or like just way too many of what you asked for, go ahead and click on that. Here's an example of using restore faces and high res fix. Right now you can see their faces are all messed up. They're all smudgy. I'm going to try it again with restore faces and high res fix on and click generate. And this is the results. And as you can see, the faces are a lot better and everything is a lot more crisp. I also raised the high res steps and all the denoising strength. I lowered it down to 0.4. And keep in mind this upscale. So it takes a while. It takes about 4 times longer than a normal picture generation. Next is the CFG scale, which is very important. And this stands for classifier free guidance scale, and this basically determines how much the system is going to listen to you and what you put. If you didn't know, you could actually hover over stuff, and then if you leave it there for a second, it'll tell you what it is or what it does. So it says here the lower the values, the more creative it is. I would stay between around like 4 and 13. I wouldn't go too far out of those ranges unless you're trying to get something a little bit more Picasso. Next is seed, and seed determines how closely you want the image to be like the last image. If you click on the green icon, it'll give you a particular seed. Now I got a seed there, 42319 4914, so I could call that back if I wanted this same batch again or this same picture. And if you just click on the dice, it's random and it's going to show you -1, and it's not going to try to stick to any particular image that you just did. Next is your image to image tab, and you could take an image, you could either inpaint on it by drawing mask on it and then trying to inpaint and change things within that mask, which is going to be a black area on the canvas, or you can change the image completely like I did here. I added a few words, I upped the denoising strength and configuration scale, and I got something a bit different but similar to the picture that I referenced. As you can see here, there's a difference between this model and the one here. I mean, a huge difference, right? But the theme is still the same, the colors and the hood and the blonde girl. So kept a lot of the same elements. And if you want to work on this picture now, you could actually send this to image now and you could iterate on this one. So I did another iteration of change, and you could see it looks fairly different from the previous one, but still keeping the same style. And the more you play with the denoising strength and the configuration scale, the more it's going to change. Going down to anything below 0.3 is going to be barely any change, and anything over 0.8 is going to be a lot of change. This was 0.8 right here that made this change. Now let's try inpainting. So click on send to inpaint, and then we're going to draw something on her. Let's change her necklace. And now I'm going to use the default settings for everything in here, and you want inpaint, mask, original, and whole picture, because this is going to paint within this area. If you say only mass, it's going to do the reverse, and the image around the black area is going to be what's changed. So just type something simple in the prompt of what you want to be within that mask. So I put a silver necklace with golden trim. Let's try that out. As you can see, we inpainted a necklace. Now let's take a look at the clip feature real quick, where it says interrogate clip. Clip stands for contrastive language image pre-training, but really what that means to you, it's the reverse of inference. So it's going to look at this picture and it's going to give you what it thinks it sees. So you can actually use this to recreate something similar to this image by using that prompt, maybe. If you really want the same image, you got to use a seed. If you look at the bottom right here, you can see the seed of this image here is 14844294. There's a lot of details to go over here in image to image, but I'm not going to do that right now. It's going to take too long. I'm going to do that in a different video. So let's check out extras now. So I created this picture to show what GFPGAN can do. And if you look right now, it doesn't really seem that bad. But if you look a little closer, her teeth in the bottom look like a bunch of pebbles. So let's throw that in GFPGAN. So I'm going to send it to extras. And I'm just going to turn up the visibility on GFPGAN all the way. And you can mess with CodeFormer, which will do something similar. Play around with both of them and see which one you like more. I'm going to click generate. And as you can see, it colored in her eyes and her teeth are normal now, which is very different than the first picture, which is right here. If you just wanted to fix that portion right there where it looks like she's chewing on a bunch of pebbles, just click on send to Inpaint, draw in the mask, and then type something in like beautiful smile or teeth and click on generate and it should fix it. As you can see here, and it fixed the rest of the photo without making too much. I mean, it does look like she has a cold sore there, but you can fix that too. Just Inpaint in that section again and just put lips or something. All right, that's all I want to show you for now, and I'm going to come out with a lot of videos on advanced techniques and different things that you can install with this thing. I've only scratched the surface. This thing has so much stuff. Anyways, thanks for watching, and if this guide helped you out, go ahead and leave a like, and I'll see you in the next video.
Okay, now I'm in this body. Thanks for watching till the end. Couldn't you transfer my consciousness into an image a bit more? Let me see. How do I put this? A bit more manly, perhaps.